Hey, how you doing? This is RJ. So, I'm sure a few of you are asking yourself, what is RJ doing putting out a video on a weekday? He hasn't done that in a while. Well, I'm putting this out on a weekday because some people might be squeamish about the subject that I'm going to talk about today, or at least some of the subject that I'm going to talk about today. And what I'm going to talk about today is this little cartoon, this little one-page story from Marvel's Voices, which was a comic that came out a couple of weeks ago. And a number of people have talked about this already. But as usual, I have my own take on what this really means in regards to a much larger picture, I think, than everyone else is looking at. But if you want to see a smaller picture of what this means, go listen to Just Some Guy's video. Actually, I'll link that in the description if you want to go watch it, because he does a very good job talking about the woman who actually wrote this little one-page cartoon and her, I don't know what, her mental problems, because that's all I can think to call them, her mental problems, because this woman's mental state does not seem to be stable. I think you can see that probably from this little cartoon itself. But before I get ahead of myself, for those people who just listen to my stuff and don't actually look at the screen, I will describe for you what this little one-page story is. It's called She-Hulk in Punishment. So you have Jennifer Walters, who is She-Hulk. She's a lawyer in her regular day, and she's standing in a courtroom with her client. And she says, "I wish I could have done more for you." And her client says, "He got 18 months. That's better than nothing. Men like him never pay for what they do to women like me." And Jennifer says, "Perhaps that's about to change." Then you see the next panel, and it's She-Hulk and some guy. I have no idea who this rando guy is. And she's in bed, and she's tossing and turning. And he says to her, "Why can't you sleep, babe? You won today." And she answers, "It's not winning when a man gets only 18 months for assaulting a woman who has worked for him for 3 years cleaning up his messes." So then the next picture is Jennifer Walters looking at herself in the mirror, seeing She-Hulk, and then she smiles to herself. Then the next panel is the man who was convicted in the courtroom. He's sitting in a police van, and he's in an orange jumpsuit, so obviously he's going to serve his 18 months. And then you see She-Hulk coming towards the van from the side of the road. She punches the van straight in the middle of the hood, which causes it to rear up on its front wheels. She basically crumples in the entire front of the van as her client is watching from the other side of the road. Then you have the man who is driving this van lying unconscious on what looks to be the airbag of this van, and his arm is hanging out the window, and he's obviously knocked out. And She-Hulk is holding in one hand the guy who had been convicted of 18 months, and her other hand is around the shoulder of her client. And she says, "Your victim wants a few minutes alone with you before you get to prison. She's the one you should be afraid of." Now, as I said, a lot of other people have talked about this, and they talked about the fact that, well, this guy that was doing his job, just driving the police van, looks like he's dead, or at the very least is severely injured. Jennifer Walters is doing things which would get her disbarred, if not thrown into prison herself. All of these other smaller things, and I'm not arguing with any of that. Some of them have a little bit of supposition behind them, whether or not what's going on in the background, but I'm not going to argue with any of that. I'm going to look at the big picture of what this is. And the reason why I'm looking at the big picture of what this is because it starts in a courtroom. And this has to do with She-Hulk, because She-Hulk supposedly is a hero. This is a picture of these new heroes that Marvel is trying to sell to you, because you have, again, Jennifer Walters, the She-Hulk. She is part of the Avengers right now. So the supposition behind this comic is that She-Hulk is indeed a hero. Even in doing all of this, she is a hero. And I would say the further supposition behind this is that in punishing this man in the way that she does, she is actually doing something just. Because again, as a hero, she does just things, supposedly, and so in punishing this man extra, over and above what the court had sentenced him to, she is doing something just. Now here's the big picture. The big picture is that this is an attack straight at the heart of what America itself is. And no, I'm not being hyperbolic, I'm not being dramatic in any way. This little cartoon is a stab at the heart of what America itself is. And why? Well, let me just read you some very familiar lines from the Declaration of Independence. "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men." So, this little cartoon starts in a courtroom, an American courtroom. And, as the Declaration of Independence says, what is government supposed to be about? Well, it's supposed to be there to safeguard the inalienable rights, the God-given rights of every American. And so the courts, who are an arm of the government, are supposed to be there to protect your God-given rights, your inalienable rights. Now, I'm going to go on some pretty long tangents here, but I'll come back to this little cartoon eventually. And I'm going to talk about God-given rights. And that's where I kind of get into the squeamish bit, because in order to talk about God-given rights, I got to talk about God. And I got to talk, to a certain extent, about politics. Now, the thing is about inalienable rights, that is defined as rights that cannot be taken away from you. That is to say, no man, no court, no government, no group of people can take those rights away from you. And they can't take them away from you because they were given to you by God. That's exactly what it means. Now, some people will say, well, you can still have inalienable rights without reference to God, but I would say, no, you can't. Because, of course, every time you remove God from this picture, you're putting everything into the hands of men. And if you look at the recent history, certainly the last 500 years of this planet, you'll see that over and over again, you have these people from governments all over the world declaring that, yes, this certain bunch of human beings are indeed human beings, but they're not full human beings, or they're not full people. Therefore, they don't get full rights. So once you put that power into the hands of human beings so that they can, in any way, touch this idea of inalienable rights, so that it comes from things like just being a human being, well then, the people start to play with the idea of what a human being is. They start to change the definition of what a person is, what a human being is, and then, therefore, who has rights. And so, they bend it and twist it and game it to their advantage. One of the beauties of having inalienable rights is the fact that they come from God, and so no one can touch them. Again, if you say that it comes from any other place, from the virtue of just being a human being, well then people are going to start redefining what being a human being means so that they can game the system to their advantage. And then everything is just out the window. And secondly, I want to say, being American is one of the most privileged thing in the entire world, in all of history, and certainly today. And I'm not using privileged in the terms of your quote-unquote progressive people. I'm saying that as an American, it's just understood that you have inalienable rights, that you have God-given rights. But it's not that way in most every other country in the world. Certainly not that way throughout history. And even today, in most Western countries, almost in every other Western country, all of Europe, Canada even, they don't have inalienable rights. They don't have God-given rights. What do they have? Well, they have rights that are granted to them by the government. And as, who was it, Washington? Thomas Jefferson? I think it was Washington said, if your government is powerful enough to give you your rights, they're powerful enough to take them away from you. And this is exactly what their courtrooms do. Because a lot of people will say, look, I'm looking at other countries. Let's take Canada for an example. And they have courts, and they don't have inalienable rights. They have rights granted to them by the government, and their courts work fine. They have justice doled out all the time. And I would say, yeah, to some extent, they work fine, but only to a point do they dole out justice. Only to a point. Because whereas in America, you have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, well, Canada has its own little trinity. And that little trinity is peace, order, and good government. And the moment these courts get to a point where your rights are starting to infringe upon peace and order and good government, well, guess what? They start to ignore them. They start to take them away. And again, no, I'm not being hyperbolic. There's an actual law on the books. It's called the War Measures Act in Canada. And it's meant so that they can use it to strip en masse the rights of its citizens. And it has been used a couple of times, and not always in war. That's just one example. Another example would be the fact that they have these things in a lot of Canada now called human rights tribunals. These are things that look like courts and that sound like courts, but they're not actually connected to the justice system. They're connected to a system all of their own, which is supposed to determine whether or not somebody's human rights have been violated. But of course, your human rights are given to you by the government and their power. Therefore, the government has the right to set up these courts. And these courts are extrajudicial. They don't have anything to do with the justice system. So they're determining rights based on something other than justice. Now, they wouldn't say that. They certainly think that that's not what they're doing at all. But really, fundamentally, that's what it is. And these courts are set up to curb the rights of people. If you look at some of the cases that have been handled by these quote-unquote tribunals, you will see that in supposedly protecting rights, they are severely limiting and taking away the rights of other people. So I would say this is an indirect way in which their government uses to curb your rights or your ability to demand those rights as an individual. So again, yeah, they have law courts and they're based upon justice, but that justice goes to a point. And that point stops when basically you start to interfere with what the government wants. Now, I don't know a whole lot about the intricacies of the legal system within Europe, but I would say the same thing is happening there. You'd have to talk to someone like, I don't know, Sargon, in order to figure that out. But I think if you look at the UK especially, where you have these massive bands of criminals who are just roaming around committing acts of injustice, criminal acts, and are not being prosecuted, they're not even being arrested. Why? Because it would cause too much of a stir. Because it would cause too much of a disruption. Their peace, their order, their good government would be disrupted. Therefore, the rights of these people, which are being violated, are simply ignored. Because, of course, the government is not there, ultimately, to protect those rights. It's ultimately there to protect its own power. And by the way, this is why I would say that the progressives absolutely need to destroy America. Because America is the only real bastion of this idea of inalienable rights. And once they get rid of that, then they can have whatever they want. Because I am going to assert, and again, I'm not being hyperbolic, I'm not exaggerating, I certainly don't think so, that every government, and that means every government throughout history and every government today, that doesn't have at its core the idea of inalienable rights is either a totalitarian government or a totalitarian government waiting to happen. And why? Because one of the rights that you have is the right to life. Every other right that you have comes secondary to your right to live. And if the government gives you that right to live, the government can take away that right to live. Therefore, if it can take away your right to live, it can take away everything. And if it has control over everything in your life in one form or another, that's a totalitarian government. And the only guardrail that people have, the only recourse that people have in order to safeguard their liberty, in order to safeguard their rights, in order to safeguard their very lives, is violence. Is their ability to revolt? Is their ability to overthrow their government? But within America, at the very least, you have another safeguard before you get to that point. By the way, I think this is why you see this mass emasculation of populations across Europe and America. Because first of all, most of these governments don't have the idea of inalienable rights. The only safeguard is the fact that they can revolt. So if you make them all wimpy little men so that they never think of revolting, well, then you can go ahead and do whatever it is you want to your population. Because that safeguard against you being a totalitarian government is gone. But in America, it's a two-pronged attack at the same time. Well, they're making wimpy people out of the next generation. Why? So that they can't revolt. And by the way, the last couple of administrations in the White House, what were they doing? Well, they were over and over again switching out judges that had this idea in their head, and you can see it through their judgments and their sentencing. They had this idea in their head that no, really, rights aren't inalienable. They're not God-given. They are given to you by the government. This is the kind of judge that they have been putting into the judicial system within America in order to just stop this idea once and for all, sometime in the near future, of the idea that you have any inalienable rights at all. That has, thankfully, been changed over the last couple of years, but that's what's going on around you. Now, as I said, that's all a huge sidetrack to one extent, but it's going to help explain what I'm going to talk about when I look at this little cartoon again. Because this little cartoon is itself a multi-pronged attack on the very idea that you have any such thing as God-given rights. And again, this is supposed to be presented to you under the guise of this woman being a hero. Now, briefly, do I think this mentally disturbed woman who wrote this little cartoon actually was trying to do this? Well, no, actually, I don't think she has the brain power to do so, but it is the ideology which she follows which is trying to do this, and this is the ideology which has taken over almost all of the comic industry and almost all of the entertainment industry. So, first of all, you have Jennifer Walters. She's in a court of law. As I said, what is the court of law supposed to do? Well, at the very least in America, and we're talking about just America here now, in America, a court of law, as an arm of the government, is supposed to be there to protect the rights of its citizens. Therefore, it's supposed to give a judgment based upon considering the rights of, in this case, the woman who Jennifer Walters is representing, and the fellow who's on the other side, and also the rights of everybody else within society, because, of course, if this guy is guilty, then you don't want him doing this to other people and violating the rights of other people as well. So here's where we get into the little nuances of what this all means. Again, you have Jennifer Walters. She has been handed down a guilty verdict, so she actually won the case. But the punishment of the 18 months of this man who is considered guilty, she doesn't consider to be good enough. Neither does the woman who was violated by this man. Now, here's where we get into something that sounds a little bit counterintuitive when you first hear it. The idea of inalienable rights grew and grew out of different ideas throughout Western civilization. And you can go as far back as Socrates and see the beginnings of this idea. It goes through Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, Cicero, Roman law, Augustine, canon law, and all of the law systems of Europe that are built upon canon law and upon Roman law. And one of the fundamental ideas that Socrates kept on pounding home was the idea that the person who commits a crime is actually punishing themselves more than the person that they have violated in committing that crime. So let me say that again, just to make sure you know that I'm being clear and not saying something I didn't mean to say. Again, within Western civilization, this idea has existed for thousands of years now, that the person who commits a crime is actually doing more damage to themselves than to any person that they violate in committing that crime. Here's one of the ways that Socrates actually says it. He says, "I maintain that it is not the most shameful thing to be wrongfully boxed on the ears, nor again to have either my purse or my person cut. Any wrong done to me and mine is at once more shameful and worse for the wrongdoer than for me to suffer." So the origin of this idea is the fact that justice is a part of your human nature. Justice is a part of being a human being. It is something fundamental to being a human being itself. It's not implanted there. It doesn't grow as you grow. It doesn't come with knowledge. It's simply there as being a human being. And so the criminal, when they are committing a crime, they are actually trying to destroy part of what makes them a human being, and they're making themselves more into a beast than a human being by committing this act. And that destruction within themselves is greater to themselves than anything that they could do to any other person. And this idea is at the heart of inalienable rights. It's saying that, yes, these rights, this justice, again, is part of your human nature. It is part of who you are as a human being, created by your creator. It is already preset within you. And so when you do commit a crime, you are indeed trying to destroy that thing within you that makes you human. You are trying to destroy, at the very least, in part, one of the essential things within you that makes you a human being. And again, that's worse than anything that you could ever do to any other human being outside of yourself. And I say all that because of the fact that here we have Jennifer Walters, and she is saying to herself over and over again in this little cartoon that this punishment for this man was not enough. And so she and the woman who was violated need to impose a stricter punishment upon this man. Now, that strikes at the very heart of the idea that this man, in getting off easy, if he did get off easy, is actually worse off than if he had actually received the quote-unquote correct punishment. So, from the ideas that inalienable rights spring from, this man, in receiving a light sentence, if it were indeed too light for what he had actually done, you should pity this man for getting a light sentence. You should not seek more punishment. And the very fact that they want to put more punishment upon him, as if he was the one who needs to be punished more, is a strike at the heart of the idea of inalienable rights, because it's a strike at the heart of the idea that justice is fundamental within the heart and nature of every human being. Secondly, if we look at the fact that Jennifer Walters and her client are going to go after this man himself and punish him more, they are declaring one of two things, perhaps both at the same time, that it's the man's fault and so he needs to be punished more, and at the same time, the court is simply not just. Because technically, if you agree to what is supposed to be assumed in an American court of law, that the court is there to balance everybody's rights out, if someone actually gets too light of the sentence, well, what are you supposed to do? Well, you're supposed to go back to the court, because it's the court decision that needs to be rectified, or at the very least, to try to rectify the laws which make this judgment or punishment necessary. So her gripe should be with the court, not with this man himself. The fact that she is actually bringing this all towards the man, and not back to the court, again, is a strike right at the heart of the idea that the court is there to protect your inalienable rights. Because if you proceed upon that assumption, then again, the court is the one that you should have a gripe with if you believe the sentence is not good enough. And, at the same time, it's a backhanded way of trying to look at the court system as if it was simply a system of power. In this woman's mind, they are writing this story as if this court system has nothing to do with inalienable rights at all. It's just a system of power, and it's easy to see why. You have your quote-unquote progressives, and they take everything and they reduce everything to this idea of power. So they truly believe that this idea that any court is there to guard your inalienable rights is just nonsense. Why? Because there's no such thing as inalienable rights. You get your rights granted by the government, whether you believe it or not, because it's all about power dynamics. They have the power, and therefore they grant the rights, and therefore they grant this court the ability to play with those rights, and we see that this ability that they have passed down from power to the government to the courts is unjust in the eyes of these two women. And again, if they believe that it's unjust, and they believed at the same time in inalienable rights, they would have recourse to the court. Their recourse would not be towards this man straight off, it would be towards the court system itself. But they don't go towards the court system, they go directly to the man. And therefore, that is another strike right at the heart of the idea that anybody has inalienable rights. Furthermore, the great thing about inalienable rights is the fact that, as I said, no man, no court, no government can touch them. We can know what they are, but no one can touch them. No one can alter them. So they are something that are objectively out there that we can know, but that we can never change. They are not part of us. They do not change with how we feel or anything subjective to us at all. They are quite objective. And that's why a court is supposed to and able to render an objective judgment and an objective punishment upon criminals, because they are taking this from the stance that they are looking at the inalienable rights of everybody involved, and they're supposed to calculate them, and they will calculate them according to an objective standard, because if we look at the only way that we can truly know these rights, we can only know them objectively. But again, here you have Jennifer Walters and her client, and they are personally imposing an extra punishment upon this man. And although Jennifer Walters, as a lawyer, should be objective, we see from this cartoon she's certainly not objective. She is making this personal, and the woman certainly is making this personal, and if they can impose what they see as a just punishment upon this man, they're saying that they are imposing this just punishment in a way that is subjective, as opposed to the idea that the court can impose this punishment upon him objectively. So if they're saying that justice is served by punishment that is doled out subjectively, they are automatically discounting justice as having any real roots within the objective idea of inalienable rights. Which, again, as I said many times, this is a strike, another strike, right at the heart of the idea that inalienable rights, that God-given rights, exist at all. So, as I have said in a number of my videos, these people, these quote-unquote progressive people, Everything for them boils down to power. And this is exactly what you see in this little cartoon, this little one-page comic about She-Hulk, Jennifer Walters, and her client. Everything is being reduced to power. They're saying that there's only a power dynamic at play within this courtroom and within justice itself, that there is no such thing as objectivity, that there is only subjectivity, and that as such, there can be no idea of inalienable rights. You have no God-given rights at all. Your rights are given to you by the government because they have the most power, and they hand that power down to the courts, and these courts dole out justice according to that power, and that's it. And that's the idea which is being sold to everybody who reads this. That's the idea behind most of what Marvel puts out there and a lot of the other comic companies as well. It's this progressive idea that it's all about power dynamics. And they want everybody, especially the next generation, to think this way, that everything is about power dynamics. Because when you make everything about power dynamics and you go up against these quote-unquote progressive kind of people, you're going to lose. You're going to lose every time. I have gone into the minds of these people that have just run this industry itself for the last couple of years in order to do these videos. Everywhere, every time, every moment of every day of every year, all they reduce everything down to is a dynamic of power. And if you have someone who spends every waking moment thinking about how to manipulate power, and you try to go up against one of these people with nothing on your side but power, you're going to lose. They know very well how to manipulate power and the trappings of power in as many ways as possible. And if you square off with them on this battlefield where the assumption is nothing exists but power, again, you're either going to lose, or the only way that you could ever even come close to beating them is to simply adopt everything that they believe. And once you do that, you're just the same as them. And if that happens, then again, you lose and they win. So really, the only way to truly beat them, the only way to truly make sure that this ideology does not win in the end, is to make sure that you don't play their game. Is to make sure that you understand what a true hero is, that you understand what justice truly is, and that you cherish and live according to statements like, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." So, if I've given you anything new to think about, hit like, hit the shield in the lower right-hand corner of your screen to subscribe, and leave me a comment. Tell me what you think about all this. All right, I'll see you later. Bye.